Well, jumping over to our top five segment, and this one was fun, man, because this week our top five is the best film in a film franchise. Because, I mean, there's so many notable franchises out there, and I definitely hit all of the ones that I know and love, and I know you did too.
Oh, yeah.
So it was a lot of fun going through and picking our favorite from each of these.
Oh, without doubt. And it's so funny because he's been doing a good job of like leaning them in. Last week we told you about the franchises that shouldn't be a fucking franchise. This week it's, we love these franchises, but we love one particular movie in these franchises the best. So, yeah, I just like how it's kind of flowing along. I'm having a good time doing these, man.
Oh, for sure. For sure. Well, number five for me goes to Star Wars, Return of the Jedi. Episode 6. I know the fan favorite is episode 5, Empire, but I don't know, man, just something about episode 6 where Luke finally realizes that the inevitable has happened and the rumors are true. Darth Vader is daddy-o. But to be able to not go to the dark side and be able to, you know, still try to bring dad back to the light and not be conflicted by, you know, the power that the Empire has, right? And then plus, come on, all the guys out there, this is the one where you get Leia in the bikini. Come on. I mean, it's true.
Yeah.
And you also get Luke. He finally has a green lightsaber, which I prefer Luke with the green than the blue.
Yeah.
But I just, you know, I enjoyed this film, I guess, more because I felt like Empire is pretty slowly paced, which rightfully so. It's still an amazing film, but I just felt like there was more intertwining.
Mm-hmm.
And I mean, it's just such an amazing story that George Lucas tells on different planets and with different characters that he shows up in the original trilogy, right? But yeah, man, I mean, Return of the Jedi, it's my all-time favorite Star Wars film. And I'll literally put that on at any point in time, definitely around Christmas time, too, when, I mean, I don't put on the Star Wars special, but I definitely watch that one because I love the Ewoks.
Yes, so, yeah, I was just going to say the Ewoks. They're so fucking awesome. It's like so many great things about Return of the Jedi. I'm right there with you, though. My number five is Star Wars 5, The Empire Strikes Back. This was the film that for me was the best in the entire franchise because it gave us everything that we needed to move forward, right? It was a little bit slower paced, but this is where Luke is dealing with the hard conflict of will he or will he not go to the dark side? Is he going to become bad, right? What's his saving grace? What the whole deal with Yoda and like where is that guidance leading him or not leading him? And how is he going to get past that? And then of course, sets up Return of the Jedi, like you just said, because it's in Empire Strikes Back at the end. The hand is chopped off by Daddy, and he finds out, right? Like, that's Dad. Oh, fuck. And he tosses Luke away, and like, oh, shit. So it sets up the redemption of Return of the Jedi and trying to get him to the, you know. So I like it, you know, because you can't have the story of Return of the Jedi and good taking down evil unless you set up the evil. And that's what I think Star Wars, The Empire Strikes Back does so brilliantly. It sets up the evil. And then you kind of root for Darth Vader. You kind of root for him. You're like, again, I think Lucas does a brilliant job of making the bad guy likeable. You want to be like, no, he's gonna be good, he's gonna turn good, he can't kill his son, and then he, like, you know, feels like, I just, for me, this is it. This is the best one in the franchise and just sets up everything that we've seen since then. And yeah, I loved it, and I'm so old that this was the second for me. I know it's Star Wars Chapter 5, but it was the second one for me because I was actually around when there was only three and we didn't have any idea he was going to call them chapters, like prequels and sequels. Like, it's like, but yeah, dude, I love it. Star Wars 5, The Empire Strikes Back.
And I mean, there's so many. I will say that Empire has way more iconic lines than any other freaking Star Wars film. I mean, you have I'm Your Father,
right?
And then you have fucking when Han's about to get frozen or get zapped into the thing where she's like, I love you. I know. Like,
yeah.
Completely ad-libbed. So good. Harrison Ford, such a badass. But yeah, I mean, there's something to say about the original trilogy. I mean, you're never going to top that.
No, I agree. I agree. Which is why I think all the new shows are leaning heavily on that. Right. Because, I mean, we see the original trilogy's influence heavily in all the new streaming shows. So.
Oh, yeah, for sure. For sure. Well, number four for me goes to Spider-Man No Way Home. I'm sure a lot of people, if you watched our best of Marvel movies, you could have anticipated this one being on the list. It's my all time favorite Marvel movie that is out to date. I don't know, the idealization and the complexities of using different parts of yourself to enhance your overall knowledge and to, you know, progress yourself to an overall goal, right? Because I mean, yes, they are coming from different dimensions and they are all different Spider-Men and they all have different storylines, but I mean, if you think about it, if you theorize it, construct it, break it down, we all use different parts of ourselves in everyday life.
Right.
You know, we could use the asshole part. We could use the really nice, happy part. We can use that middle of the road, just try to get through your day type thing. So, I mean, I kind of view it as that. And I mean, plus, I think overall, it was just cinematically beautiful. That scene where it's in the rain and he's like in New York City across from the LED big freaking billboard. Oh, it was so beautiful, man. To see that in the theater was just epic. And I mean, to bring back Garfield and to bring back Maguire, I mean, it's hard to top that. It's really hard to top that. But yeah, man, number four for me, Spider-Man, No Way Home.
Good one. Good one. My number four, I had a hard time. I was going back and forth between Winter Soldier and Civil War. And I ended on Captain America Civil War because it has all of the great stuff from Winter Soldier, but then also starts to now lay down the aspect of the moral. Both Tony and Steve want the same things, but one is not willing to cross a line and one is. And you start to get into that battle of what is morally right and what will you or won't you do to achieve the same goal. And that's where why I kind of leaned this way. I love that both of them are basically, like I was saying about Superman and Lois, it's basically this like political drama that has superheroes in it. This is a breakdown of society and how you view right and wrong and what you're willing to do or not do that happens to have superheroes in it. Like, you know, and that to me is, it makes it, it, in fact, Winter Soldier and Civil War might even be like lean towards my favorites in the entire MCU franchise. I just think they were really well done because they weren't done as superhero movies, you know? And how often in life are we forced to choose a side? What side are you going to be? Are you going to be willing to do this or are you not? And how many times in life do we try to justify doing something bad by saying we're doing it for the right reason? I know it's bad, but we're doing it for the right reason because we want something good. And I just really loved how this film played into that. I mean, Tony's not a bad guy. He's just willing to do bad shit to get shit done. And, you know, Boy Scout Steve is not. So yeah, I feel like that's all of us in life. Like you just said, we all sometimes are the asshole, we're all sometimes the good guy, and sometimes we're just right down the middle. And I feel like that's the perfect example of this film. And there you go. So my number four, Captain America, Civil War.
I know, it's funny, when I was making my list, it was Winter Soldier, and then you probably thought about it more, and you're like, nah, I gotta switch it back.
Yeah, no, yeah, it was right there, though. I feel like they could have both been right there, you know?
Yeah, for sure, for sure. Well, number three for me goes to the Harry Potter franchise. And in this one, we're talking about Prisoner of Azkaban. I believe this is the next one that you need to watch because I think you've only watched the first two.
Three so far.
Yeah, you've watched three of them?
Yeah.
Finally, thank goodness. Yeah, this that
I'm trying to roll that, through them. Yeah.
The third one is my favorite, Prisoner of Azkaban, because you get introduced to Commissioner Gordon himself, Sirius Black. that man plays every iconic role ever. But I love this film because not only are they finally starting to come of age, but this is the darker, grittier Harry Potter that you finally get to see from the books. And right. There's so much, you know, he said, she said in society, right? Where people try to blast people. They try to make people out to be the villain. And this film depicts perfectly that you can't always listen to people, because Sirius Black the whole time is made out to be the bad guy, when in fact he is not the bad guy, not at all. He is actually the good guy. He is Harry's godfather. Spoiler alert, if you've been living under a rock. But it's one of those things where you can't always listen to what everybody else is saying. You have to find out for yourself. You have to experience a person or a situation yourself before coming to your own conclusion. And that's what I love about this film, because it's finally when I feel like Harry is able to stand up and be his own person, you know, be able to figure out what is right and what's wrong for himself. Yep. So that's why I love it so damn much. But yeah, Prisoner of Azkaban, number three.
That's a good one. And I agree with you. I think that we finally start to see the dark and gritty because they're finally old enough. The first two, you don't want to go there because they're still little squeaky clean kids, you know? But as now we're starting to see that transition into adulthood, and you're like, oh, okay, maybe now we can start to, you know, get there. Right. I like that though. I agree with that. My number three, it's like one of the greatest cinematic lines of all time. Khan! When you know, Captain Kirk screaming Khan's name, it's one of the most iconic scenes and lines in all of film. Ricardo Montalban as Khan. It's one of the greatest characters, in my opinion, ever created. He originally debuted in the original series in the 60s, and then he's sent off. You know, Kirk defeats him, and he's like put on this planet in isolation. But he comes back, he gets off, and sets up this epic showdown between Kirk and Khan trying to get revenge for being dumped off on this planet and basically left to die. And it's just the back and forth between Shatner's Kirk and Ricardo Montalban's Khan in this entire film is fucking fantastic. It's so beautifully written. And it really, again, goes to the whole good and evil and what you're willing to do and the lines that you're willing to cross. Because Kirk in this is willing to cross fucking lines to end Khan and vice versa. And of course, this is it. It's like what you said about Empire Strikes. This one's got some of the best lines. There's a whole passage, and I'm not even going to try to remember all the words that Khan gives this long, huge speech to Kirk, right? And then Kirk, like I said, yelling, Khan! And then, of course, you know, I have been and always shall be your friend. Because this is the movie, this is the one, fucking Spock dies, sacrifices his life, and they're up against that radiation tube, and his face is all fucking melting off, and Kirk is up against it, and he puts the hands up with the live long and prosper, and he's like, I always have been your friend. Oh my god, everybody's fucking tearing up. It's like, Spock's fucking dead? What the fuck? They killed Spock? And they send him off in the tube with the Scottish playing bagpipes with Scotty, and like, yeah. It was so... there wasn't a single person in the theater that wasn't fucking crying. Everybody's fucking crying. And again, another line that Kirk is saying, that of all the people that he's known throughout his life or whatever, Spock was the most human. Yeah, because he's like half human, but he's like, he's the most fucking human. He's my best fucking friend, and now he's fucking dead. And it was just so good. It's like one of, it hands down the best in the entire series. And I'm talking not just of the original, but of next generation of, like, best in the fucking series. That movie right there. Woo! Such a good movie. Of course, for all you know, Spock came back. He was regenerated on Genesis. Wasn't really dead. He got all of his memories back because he fucking mind melded with Doc because he knew he was going to fucking die. He's like, no, I got to put my shit in your head because I know I'm going to fucking die. but it's just a great movie. If you got, plus, it's the first one where we see those badass fucking jacket uniforms. Yeah, they find because those first fucking uniforms in the original Star Trek The Motion Picture, like, what the fuck were they wearing there? But this is all their fancy, like, cool uniforms. So, yeah, I love this movie. Star Trek II, The Wrath of God. As if you couldn't tell. I just fucking love this movie. No.
If you couldn't tell. Number two for me should, I feel like people would know. And, I mean, it's literally the reason why I wanted to become a filmmaker. And, I mean, of course, the brilliance of Heath Ledger, the why so serious? But, I mean, it's just, like, one of the best things of all time. I'm talking about The Dark Knight. I mean, Dark Knight Rises was fine. I really didn't have much of a problem with it. It was pretty cool. Anne Hathaway, you know, Killian Murphy and all. I mean, and Demi Bart. Batman Begins was fine too. Like, it was definitely my least favorite of the trilogy, but I mean, The Dark Knight, man. I mean, Christopher Nolan, Christian Bale, Michael fucking Caine, who recently announced his retirement. I just, you know, it's one of the best movies of all time. Literally one of the best movies of all time. I've said so much about it on this show, and everybody probably knows how much it means to me, but yeah, I mean, come on. The Dark Knight. I mean, he's the one and only true Batman. Come on. So it just is what it is.
Fuck you, Keaton.
It's fine. It's fine.
but it is a phenomenal movie. And if you're going to try to get out of the shadows of Keaton and Jack Nicholson, this was the movie to do it because their portrayals as Batman and Joker were top notch. I mean, it was fucking, I'm right there with you. It's fucking great. And it's funny because then I parlay into my number two, which is also the movie that made me want to be a filmmaker because I consider Superman the movie and my number two, Superman 2, all one movie because it is basically, even Donner tells you it's all one fucking movie. Superman 2, specifically the Richard Donner cut, hands down, when he's taking on Zod, and now we've overdone Zod too many fucking times. We don't need to see Zod anymore. We don't need to see Luthor anymore. Can we just do some Superman movies without these guys? But this movie, when he takes on the three, and you know, the whole kneel before Zod, and it, you know, and then he gives up his powers and he becomes human for the love of Lois, and you know, and then the trickery where he knows Luthor's gonna, you know, lie and turn on him, and he tricks them into getting their powers lost, and he gets his powers back, and just, yeah, it's just so badass. It's about the guy knowing who he is. He's willing to give up everything that he is for the love of this woman and to be human, and then realizes it was the greatest mistake of his life because now this beloved world that he's a part of and these people that he loves are in jeopardy of dying because he gave up who he was. It's like, it's the ultimate story of you don't have to sacrifice who you are to be with somebody or to care for somebody. You have to stay who you are. And yeah, it's just, it's so fucking good. The scene where he's like crushes his fucking hands and lifts them up in the air, or the scene where he gets his ass kicked in the diner but then goes back with his powers and fucking kicks the guy's ass. He's like working out, you know, kind of, it's all good. And of course it sets up the kids. I mean, when he didn't have his powers, him and Lois. And as we know, down the line, she has a kid. Kids. So, yeah, it's just hands down, the best. We can skip fucking 3 and 4. I didn't hate Superman Returns because it was the continuation of this and we see the kid and everything. But literally, you could just leave it at 1 and 2. And just for me, I would be fine with that. And then pick up with Tyler Hoechlin and the gang. But yeah, Superman 2, best in the franchise by far. By far.
There it is. There it is. And number one for me goes to Home Alone 2, Lost in New York. You should have only made these two. None of these reboots. None of this garbage ass trash that is out there right now. You all don't understand how frustrating it makes me. Because Culkin's the guy. Culkin is the guy. You don't need any other child. Fuck all those kids. I don't care about them, okay? He is the guy. I just... It makes me so mad. I love the first one. Don't get me wrong. I have to watch both of them back to back. But I've talked about this before on the show. I just... New York City, it is... It's literally the city of lights. And, like, just to be able to... Or the city that never sleeps. I just... The backdrop is amazing. Him being older, I feel like makes it more real, especially with going to a different city. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. We do get a cameo appearance from old 45 there, but you know, it's one of those things that I feel like is irreplaceable. Those two movies, specifically the second one, it's my favorite movie of all time. Home Alone 2, Lost in New York is my favorite movie of all time, and nobody should ever touch anything like it again. So hopefully we'll never go into that dark place again that we call Hollywood and remakes and revisions and reboots and all the stupid shit. I'm just saying, Home Alone 2, Lost in New York, favorite movie of all time.
Wow. That is saying a lot. When you say... Boom, favorite movie of all time. Woo.
I know.
Yeah, wow. I'm just going to leave it at that. I don't even know what to say to that. I don't even know what to say to that. My number one is considered by many as the greatest film of all time. Not just your favorite or my favorite, but the greatest film of all time ever made. And it is by far the best in the franchise. Number two was good. Number three, maybe we didn't have to see. It was not bad, but it wasn't necessary in my opinion. Yeah. But number two, yeah. But I am, of course, talking about The Godfather. The fucking Godfather. There's no way that anybody can say that two or three is their favorite in the franchise. Because there's no fucking way. One is always going to be the favorite in that franchise. There's no fucking way. Because I can never really answer what is my favorite film of all time. I can't. I go back and forth with so. But this is definitely in consideration. Like, this is, like, it's definitely near the top. There's no doubt about that. Can I get it to my favorite of all time? I don't know, because I truthfully have yet to figure out what my favorite film of all time is. I haven't. I desperately am trying to figure that out so when somebody asks me, I can finally say, this is my favorite film of all time, but I'm not quite there yet. But this film, Godfather... Hands down my favorite in the franchise, one of my all-time favorite franchises, period, and definitely one of my all-time favorite films and one of the greatest films of all time. From everything. I'm talking from the writing, the acting, the directing, the storytelling, the cinematography. Every single thing about this fucking film is epic. Which is why it was at number one on my list for favorite films in a franchise. And honestly, I cannot wait to get back out to the Los Angeles Academy Museum because they've got a fucking Godfather exhibit now. They were telling us about it when we were there the last time. And the actual fucking office, Corleone's, I can't even wait to get the fuck back out there and see that shit because that's going to be badass. But yeah, my number one, The Godfather.
So many good things, man. So many good things on this list. And I love every single movie that's on here besides Star Trek. I'm not a Star Trek person, man. I've tried. I can't do it.
I would argue if you watch Star Trek 2, The Wrath of Khan, you will like it. Yeah, and I'm not saying even watch any of the rest of the franchise. I'm just, if you watch that film and treat it as a solo film,
yeah,
I think you would really like it. Just the story.
So I don't have to watch anything else just to watch that one.
No, and I mean, everybody, even if you're not even a Star Trek fan, you know the relationship between Kirk and Spock and McCoy and the core group, right?
Yeah.
I just think even if you just watched this, and I just told you, the character, like, you know, Khan is a engineered super being meant to be, like, you know, the superior humans and you know, introduced in the 60s, but you really just, they even kind of tell you all that in the movie. So even if you weren't a fan of the series, they kind of give you the update of who he is and why he's pissed.
That's always good.
But yeah, I would argue that if you watched that movie just as a solo movie, I think you would like it because it's a great story and it's done well and it's very dramatic. There's humor, but then there's also when he dies, obviously it's one of the most touching kind of things, but there's the humor, you know, like when Doc finds out that he got fucking mind melded, he's like that green blooded fucking, why'd he put this shit in my head? Like, you know, kind of a, it's yeah, I would argue that you would like that film.
We'll see, man. We'll see. Maybe one of these days. One of these days.
If I can watch Harry Potter, you can watch fucking Star Trek too, okay?
All right. Yeah, okay, that's fair.